Well, our subject this morning is Lessons from the Good Shepherd. And what we're going to do is a deep dive into the 23rd Psalm. Now, all of you, or most of you, probably memorized the 23rd Psalm when you were little, right? Like me, like that was the first scripture you had to memorize in Sunday school and children's church and vacation Bible school, the 23rd Psalm. I bet we know it verbatim. Let's try it. Let's do it together. The Lord is, I shall not. He maketh me in green pastures. He restoreth. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod, thy staff, they do what? They comfort me. Thou preparest before me in the presence of mine. Thou anointest with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. How long? All the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for how long? Forever. Wow, some of us knew that. Miss Brown. Amen. You knew that verbatim, all right? So, yes, I remember having to learn that from the King James Version. And whenever I say it, I always say it from the King James Version with the thus and the thou and all of that. Amen? Amen. So, the 23rd Psalm is said to be the most quoted and most memorized scripture in the Bible. You've probably heard it at funerals. It's been read or quoted at the bedside of loved ones who were passing away or who were deathly ill. Soldiers say it in battle. Prisoners say it when they are in prison, when they're walking the last mile to execution. Usually the chaplain is reading the 23rd Psalm. We've all probably said it or thought about it when we were in some kind of trauma, in some kind of event that we couldn't see our way out of. Psalm 23 is said to have been written by King David. And we know that King David went through a lot of stuff in his life. We've just finished a series on lessons from the fallen kings. So we learned some things about King David in that. If you were to look in your Bible, it would probably say that this is a psalm of David. And we think that David wrote it as an adult after he had gone through some stuff, because we know that he had to depend on the Good Shepherd. And we know that David knew what characteristics or qualities that a shepherd needed, because David himself had been a shepherd. Remember that he was out in the field tending the sheep when Samuel the prophet came to anoint the second king of Israel. We know that his father did not consider him as a king. He was out in the field and he thought his other sons would probably be anointed, because being a shepherd was considered the lowliest position in the family. So David was out there tending his sheep. We believe that Psalm 23 was written by David when he was going through a traumatic event in his life. If you remember the story of David, all that stuff that they went through, we don't have time to recount this morning, but we know that one of David's sons raped his sister, his half-sister, and that half-sister's brother killed that half-brother. And Absalom was the one that killed his brother, and he got angry with King David because he didn't do anything about his daughter being raped. So Absalom took it into his own hands, killed his brother, and he wanted to overturn the kingdom. He wanted to be the king. So he was out to kill his father. So it was during this time, it is believed, when David sent his soldiers to fight against Absalom's soldiers, David wrote Psalm 23. David loved his soldiers and cared about them, but he also loved his son. So he was waiting to hear, is my son still alive? He directed his soldiers not to kill his son, even though his son wanted to kill him and wanted to kill his soldiers. He told his soldiers, keep my son alive. So it's believed that it was during that time when David was waiting to hear back from his soldiers whether his son was alive or not, that he wrote Psalm 23. Now that's a little bit about David. Let me tell you something about sheep. Sheep are said to be the dumbest animals in the world. In fact, when there's a herd of sheep and the lead sheep goes to the edge of the cliff and falls off, every one of them behind him will come and fall off too. Now you would think that if you saw one of them fall off, you wouldn't go up there, right? You wouldn't fall off too. Have you ever been standing from a mom and dad or grandma and they said, if your friend jumps off a cliff, are you gonna jump too? That's where that comes from the sheep. Because sheep will do that. One sheep will come to the edge, fall off. All of them, if they're not stopped, they will all fall off that cliff. Wow. That's why they're called the dumbest animals in the world. You heard the saying also, it's like leading a lamb to slaughter. So when lambs or sheep are lined up to get slaughtered, the sheep will see the first one got slaughtered. You would think they'd be scared, but they just line up, say, I'm next. So a lot of manipulative, cunning men do that to gullible women. All they have to do is give one compliment. Baby, you look good. You're fine. Look at your legs. Wow. Girl, you didn't have to do that. And that's all they have to do is come on. It's like leading a lamb to slaughter. Like, it doesn't matter that we know that he's got 10 baby mamas, okay? All he has to do is say, girl, you number one. And here we go, right? Leading a lamb to slaughter, gullible women, right? Conniving men, just like the wolves that entice sheep to leave the shepherd, right? Sheep are also said to wander. Usually they stay close together in herds, but they also wander off. And when they wander off, the shepherd has to go and get them and bring them back. If they keep wandering and keep wandering, the shepherd has to do something that seems very drastic. But the intention is to keep the sheep dependent on the shepherd. So they'll go and get the sheep, gently break the front legs of the sheep, so that the sheep won't wander off. And that's so that the sheep will become totally dependent on the shepherd. The shepherd will go and get that sheep, put him on his shoulders, take him back to the herd, and nurse him back to health. That's a slide of a shepherd with a sheep. And I saw one of these pictures when I was praying for one of our sons that was going crazy when he was a teenager. If you could bring that slide up with the shepherd with the sheep. And I remember seeing the good shepherd had a little lamb under his arm. So I prayed and gave God permission to break that son's legs. Do whatever you got to do to bring him back. Because whatever we were doing was not working. And we quickly saw that he was either going to be in jail or in the grave. So I gave God permission to break his legs. I wanted him to be like that little lamb. You see how that lamb's head is laying on the shepherd's shoulder? I wanted him to hear God's heartbeat. I wanted him to hear what God's plan for his life was. And it took some time. It took some prayers. It took a lot of doing, but God answered that prayer, and that son has been restored. Praise God. So I know that prayer changes things. But sometimes we have to let go of them and allow God to break their legs. Amen? Amen. Sometimes that means jail. Sometimes that means heartbreak. Sometimes that means homelessness. Whatever he has to do, just trust God that God has him tucked under his arm with his head on his shoulder. Sometimes sheep look for the grass being greener on the other side. We've heard that saying before, the grass looks greener on the other side. That also comes from sheep. Shepherds find green pastures in Israel. There are a lot of barren areas like deserts where there's no water and no green vegetation. So shepherds have to find those places. And when they do, their sheep graze there. And they always find a pasture by running water so that the sheep can drink from there. But sheep are always trying to get out. They're trying to get out of the pen that the shepherd builds so that the sheep can go in at night and sleep. And it said that the shepherd lays himself across the gate. And there is a scripture, John 10:7. You bring that up. There is one way into the sheep pen and there's one way out. So at night, the shepherd lays himself across the gate. That's to keep the sheep in, to protect them, and to keep the wolves and the other animals that are just waiting to get to these little timid sheep as their prey. So the scripture reads, "Then Jesus said to them again, 'Most assuredly I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture.'" So David put that in this psalm because David himself had been a shepherd and had laid himself across the gate. Now, how many times have we been inside of the sheep pen and stepped right over the good shepherd? The grass looks greener over there. Ooh, that eye candy. He's tall, dark, handsome, got a Barry White voice. I'm stepping right over the shepherd and I'm going on out there, because when we do that, we are telling the good shepherd, I know better than you what's best for me. I know what I want, but inside of this fence, inside of this sheep pen is everything that I need, but that's what I want. So I'm gonna step over the good shepherd. He's laying there, trying to keep me in, trying to keep the wolves out, and here comes the wolf in sheep's clothing, luring me out. Come on, baby, you look good, you look fine. I got this and I got that. Yeah, I want that. We will find a crack in the fence, go under, go over, any way we can get out of the sheep pen, we're gonna do that. But when we're out there, we're vulnerable to the wolves in sheep's clothing. They look good, they're packaged fine, everything is going well, but once we're out there, we become their prey. Also, sheep are very sensitive to sounds. It is said that several herds of sheep can be grazing in the same pasture, drinking from the same water, but one shepherd can make a sound, and his sheep know his sound. Doesn't even have to say a word. You can just make a sound like, and his sheep will stop grazing and follow him. John 10:27-28. Jesus says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand." Wow. The good shepherd. He's saying that we, his sheep, those of us who have accepted Christ as our Savior, those of us who have confessed with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our hearts that God raised Jesus from the dead, are his sheep. We hear his voice. We follow him. Sometimes we find a way to get out of that sheep pen, but even so, he says that no one can snatch them out of my hands. That wolf in sheep's clothing, the one that's luring us out, what we want is out there, and we climb out of that fence, but still, we are his sheep. We're in his hands, so we have his protection. That means that the devil can only do so much, can only go so far with us, because we're still in his hand. We might have to go through some stuff, some heartache, some heartbreak, some losses, but we are restored in him, and we're going to talk about restoration in a minute. So let's do this deep dive into Psalm 23. Let's look at verse number 1. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." Notice it says my shepherd. That means it's personal. That means that David had a personal relationship with the Lord. We know that David was called the apple of God's eye. Even though David went through a lot of heartache, he was still the apple of God's eye. And we know that David caused a lot of that on himself. He lusted after women. He murdered. He had an adulterous affair. He did a lot, brought a lot of stuff on his own, but he was still the apple of God's eye, and God kept restoring him. "I shall not want" means that the good shepherd has everything that we need. Everything that we need, emotionally, physically, in every aspect of our lives, he has it. But many times we turn away from him. Many times we find a way to get out of the sheep pen where everything is provided, And we want more. We want something bigger. We want something better, something brighter, something that we think is better for us. But God has already given us everything that we need. Verse number 2, he maketh me lie down in green pastures. Green pastures represent everything that we need as well, everything that we need for life and for godliness. Notice it says he maketh me. Now, I told you a couple of minutes ago about the shepherd breaking the legs of the sheep. It is said that that's what that he maketh me means. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He has to go and get me and break my legs to make me see, I have given you everything that you need. Here's the green pasture right here. It's not greener over there. It just looks greener. But what you need is right here, and I've provided everything for you. Sometimes we have to come back with broken legs, broken hearts. We've lost everything, lost our homes, lost our jobs, because we have not stayed within that sheep pen and listened and followed the Good Shepherd. Verse number 3, he restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. I've just told you about David, how he restored David's soul. David had an adulterous affair. He had the woman's husband killed. When the baby came, baby got sick, David fasted and prayed and cried out to God for many days. But God said no. He did not allow the baby to live. So what did David do? He got up, washed himself off, cleaned himself up, ate something, and went to the temple and worshiped God. And he called on Yahweh, the God of the Old Testament, that you're still God. And God restored him back to where he was before. So God does the same thing for us. He's always loving, always kind, always ready and willing to forgive us. But we have to realize that we have stepped out of the sheep pen. We've gone our own way. We've rejected God. So we have to come to a place of repentance and ask for forgiveness. And he's ready and willing to forgive us and to restore us, to lead us in paths of righteousness. It says, for his name's sake. And for his name's sake, it means that for his glory, he gets the glory. When we are restored after committing some sin or after stepping over him and stepping out of that sheep pen, he restores us, and that makes him famous. As Pastor Devin always says, let's go and make God famous. That makes God famous in the earth when he restores his sheep back to the fold. Verse number 4, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Now notice it said walk through the valley of the shadow of death. It doesn't say you stay there. Going through the valley of the shadow of death, I'm not staying there, but I'm walking. Sometimes it's a slow walk. Sometimes it's a slow walk through depression, through loneliness, through a feeling of forgotten. Somebody's forgotten me. Somebody's abused me. Sometimes it's a slow walk. But we have to keep in mind that the Good Shepherd is right there with us. Psalm 32, verse 8, it's not going to come on the screen, but it says, I will teach you, I will instruct you in the way you should go. I will guide you with my eye. That means that his eyes are on us no matter what we're going through. We might crawl out of that pen many times in our lives. We step over the Good Shepherd that's lying at the gate many times in our lives, but he goes back and gets us, puts us on his shoulders, sometimes has to break our legs to get our attention so that we will be totally dependent on him. When he breaks the legs of the sheep, they become totally dependent on him because they can't walk. So he has to feed them. He has to give them water. He has to nourish them, and he carries them with him wherever he goes. When we are walking through the valley of the shadow of death, we become more intimate with God, because what else are we going to do? We have nobody else to call on. Our friends have left us. How many people have lost everything, and you turn around and look, and your friends are all gone? I hear so many wealthy people who have lost everything say that all my friends are gone. Many sports figures who have fallen, many wealthy people who had a lot of money, had a lot of businesses, but for some reason or another, they lost everything. They look back, sometimes their families are gone. Their friends are gone. They have no one else to turn to. And sometimes it takes that for us to call on the name of the Lord, because when everything is going well, when everything is fine, when we're feeling good, we don't think about spending time with the Lord. But when you're going through the shadow of the valley of death, you're going to get on your knees, aren't you? You're going to spend some time in the Word. You're going to be praying. You're going to be asking God, why me? A lot of us ask, why me? Why am I going through this? If you're so good, God, if you're the good shepherd, why am I going through this? And that's when we need to check ourselves to see, well, what is it about me? What am I doing? What am I not doing? What do I need to be doing? Did I step over the good shepherd to get what I thought I wanted? I'm telling the good shepherd that what you're giving me is not good enough. I want something else. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. We know about shadows. Probably when you were younger, or maybe your children might be afraid of shadows. They are creepy. They're dark. They look evil. I know that when children are outside and the sun is straight over them and they're looking for their shadow and they finally see their shadow, they try to run from their shadow. You can't get away from it. But notice that it is the shadow of death. It's not death itself. So even though you may be going through a deep depression, you may be going through something drastic, it is not unto death. That is where God wants you to be, to restore you so that you can be intimate with Him, so that you can memorize Scripture, you can study the Word, you can pray, and you can talk to God and listen. That's one thing that we miss. We don't listen. We want to pray and go on to work. We want to pray in the car. We want to pray while we're eating, but we don't take time to listen to what God is saying to us. He's said that He will teach us, He will instruct us in the way we should go, and He will keep His eye on us. And what's the difference between teaching and instructing? Teaching is giving information. You can do whatever you want to do with it. But when I instruct you, the Greek word for instruct means that I make you understand. And again, we go back to that word, maketh me lie down. God has to make us do it so that we will follow His plan and not ours. Verse 4, also your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Now, the rod and the staff is not two things. It's one stick with two purposes. One end of the stick is called the rod. It's kind of a pointed end of the stick, and that's used for the shepherd to fight off the wolves, to fight off the animals that come to prey on the sheep. It's also a comforting stick because the shepherd uses it to kind of tap the sides of the sheep that are trying to stray away. So it gives them comfort to just gently tap them to get them back in line. But the staff has a crook at the end. The other end of the stick is called the staff. It has a crook. When a sheep is wandering away, the shepherd just takes the staff and hooks it around the sheep's neck and pull him back. How many times of us have we been hooked? The Lord puts the staff around our neck and just hooks us back over. Getting ready to go somewhere, you know you're not supposed to be going, that hook. I think I better stay at home. How many of us have sneaked out the back door of the basement after mom and daddy? You don't have to raise your hand. After mom and daddy goes to sleep, you're waiting to midnight. Yeah, I hear them snoring. I'm going to sneak out the back door. Sneak out the window. Or maybe leave the window open and let the wolf in. That happens too. But that sneaking out of the sheep pen, it's safe in the sheep pen, but we want to sneak out because we want to have fun. It looks good. He looks good. She looks good. I think I want that, but that's not what we need. Everything that we need is in the sheep pen. Psalm 100, verse 3 says that we are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Now, I wonder why God calls us His sheep. He calls His people sheep. We already said that sheep are dumb. We said that sheep wander. sheep look for greener grass on the other side. Wonder why there are so many references to God's people being sheep. Makes you wonder why we are called sheep. Wow. Verse 5, you prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. I want you to think about this visual. I want you to think about a banquet. And all of us have probably been to a banquet or a big dinner where food is laid out, man. I want you to think of a continual banquet where the food never runs out. Everything that we need is on that table. Peace is on that table. Goodness, kindness, mercy is on that table. Everything that we need to get through life and to be holy, to be godly, is on that table. It says that God sets that table in the presence of our enemies. Now, our enemy, we know our arch enemy is Satan. But he brings a whole lot of other stuff with him. Brings sadness, brings depression, brings loneliness, brings all kinds of labels that people put on us. PTSD, ADHD, ADD, all of those acronyms. Everything that people put on us, Satan brings with him. And in the midst of all of that, God lays out this table with everything that we need on it. This table represents abundance and sufficiency. And provision. It's a continual thing. You anoint my head with oil. It was an honor to be invited to a banquet during David's day. You were considered an honored guest. An honored guest always got anointed with oil. And the anointing is the sanctification, the setting apart. So we know that King David and Saul and all the kings were anointed to be king. Samuel came to anoint David as king. So an anointing with oil is a very special thing. It's an honor to be anointed. And the oil represents the refreshing. And it says that my cup overflows. That means that whatever is in that oil, whatever is in that anointing, you have enough for you and it overflows so that you can share it with somebody else. How many of you have walked up to somebody and given them a hug and they started crying and said, you just don't know. That was just what I needed right now. I've been through so much. You may have called somebody or texted somebody, and it did so much for them. You may have smiled at somebody. I said an encouraging word. All of that is the overflowing of the anointing that is upon you. God anoints you with kindness, with goodness, with that smile so that you can share it with somebody else and make somebody else feel better. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Now, goodness and mercy are considered twin angels. They come together, goodness and mercy. And goodness is, and that's slide number 8. Yeah, goodness and mercy, if you would put up the slide for the definitions for goodness and mercy. Goodness is kindness, benevolence, benefit, and welfare. And mercy is unmerited favor. That means that we don't get what we deserve. We deserve death. We deserve punishment. But God restores us. He is loving. He is kind. He's merciful. He's forgiving. And he restores us even though we don't deserve it. The verb to follow in the Greek means the same as a word that describes an animal in pursuit of its prey. Goodness and mercy is just like an animal chasing after another animal. If you've ever seen the National Geographic Channel or the Discovery Channel, you've seen animals who wait to prey upon other animals, just like wolves wait to prey upon sheep because they're so timid and so dumb. So goodness and mercy, when we're walking through the valley of the shadow of death, when we're going through our stuff, when we're going through heartache and depression, goodness and mercy is right there behind us on our tail. It gives me comfort to know that when I am feeling down or when I'm going through something, when my family rejects me, when my friends turn their backs on me, goodness and mercy is pursuing me, is chasing me down. I want you to remember that today, that whenever you're going through your stuff, the life happens, we say. When life happens, remember that goodness and mercy is on your tail. chasing you down, pursuing you, wanting to take over you. And it says that in that verse 6, it says that not only in this life will goodness and mercy pursue me, but forever, until I take my last breath, goodness and mercy is right there with me. Remembering that the Good Shepherd teaches us, instructs us in the way we should go. He watches us with his eye. He's with us when we're going through the valley of the shadow of death. He's right there with us. He sees everything that's going on. And then on top of that, we have the twin angels. We have goodness and mercy pursuing us, just like a vicious animal is pursuing its prey. So we have no reason not to make it. We have no reason to say, I can't make it. We have no reason to say, I want to kill myself. Nobody loves me. The world would be better off without me. A lot of suicidal people think that everybody would be better off if I were not here. Because goodness and mercy, I want you to get a picture of that. When I'm going through life, when things are getting me down, right behind me, the twin angels, goodness and mercy, they're pursuing me. There are some lessons that we need to take in from Psalm 23. Remember the title was Lessons from the Good Shepherd? There are 6 lessons. If we could put that slide up. The first one is that the Lord is our personal shepherd, and that's from verse 1, number 1. He's my shepherd. He's not a shepherd or the shepherd. He's my shepherd. That means I have a personal relationship with him. He's willing and able to meet every one of our needs. He has the ability. He has it all. All we do is have to call on him. All we do is have to stay within his will. We have to stay inside the sheep pen, people. We can't step over the Good Shepherd. We can't find a crack and try to get out and find things on our own. Stay inside the sheep pen. He's a providing shepherd. Verse 2, he supplies all our needs, spiritual, emotional, financial, personal, everything. He supplies it. He has everything that we need for life and for godliness. Number 3, he's a pardoning shepherd. Verse 3, when we wander away from the sheepfold, he gently restores us. Sometimes he has to break our legs. I'm sorry. Sometimes he has to break our legs to bring us back to the sheepfold, to restore us. He has to make us lie down in the green pastures and what he has provided for us, because we don't get it. We think the grass is greener over there. We see something else we want. We're on the path that God has planned for us. But hey, that looks good over there. I want that better than I want what God has for me. He's a protecting shepherd. In verse 4, he protects us from the enemy and guides us when we want to stray away. Remember the rod and the staff. The rod protects us from our enemies. Number 5, he's a preparing shepherd. He prepares everything that we will need in life before we need it. That means that the table is already set, waiting for us. We're his honored guests. He's waiting to anoint us with oil. But it's us. We keep getting in our own way. We keep stumbling over ourselves. We keep sneaking out of the sheep pen rather than staying in where everything is already laid out for us. And the last one, pursuing shepherd, he chases after us the way an animal chases after its prey. I want you to leave here today with that visual in mind, that the twin shepherd's goodness and mercy chase after me like an animal pursuing its prey. Amen? What do we do with the lessons from the Good Shepherd? Here are our next steps. I know most of you probably already know Psalm 23, but I want you to read it without saying it rotely, the way we always do. Sometimes I can say Psalm 23 without even thinking, you know, while I'm doing something else because it's in me. But read Psalm 23 this week and ask the Good Shepherd to show you where you have been sneaking out of the sheep pen. What am I doing? When is it that I'm stepping over you? You're guarding the gate, but I keep stepping over you. Where is it that I'm stepping over you? Where is it that I'm finding a crack in the sheep pen and I keep sneaking out? Show me. repent from it, ask for forgiveness, and make a commitment to stay in the sheepfold and follow him wherever he leads. Remember, the scripture says that we know his voice. We will not follow a thief or a robber. We won't follow the wolf in sheep's clothing, but we will follow him. Make sure that we're doing that, and that wherever he leads us, that's where we're going to follow. Amen. Let's stand to our feet.